Hi, this is Tamsen Granger.
So Dan Abuhoff.
With Tamsen and Dan, read the paper. It's Sunday, May 26, 2019, and it's a special, special day. We're in Greenville, South Carolina, for the wedding of...
You'll get it.
What?
Go ahead.
Elaina Granger and Brendon Casabon.
That's probably right. That's good.
And we got here just yesterday. Turns out Greenville is a delightful place.
Well, first of all, it's a hell of a lot bigger than I thought it was.
Oh, it is.
It's huge. It's like a big city.
We've just been in one little corner of it.
I'm telling you, it's teeming with people. But it's very nice. It's extremely nice. I agree.
And we have special guests today.
Yeah.
Okay. We have Bryan and Jenn Granger and Brendon and Courtney Granger. Okay. Who are going to help us out with some conversations.
When you say it, it sounds exciting. But yeah. Yes, they are.
It is exciting.
It is exciting. Well, they're here. They're the cousins here for the wedding.
They're our cousins.
Nephews, nieces, whatever.
Sons of the famous Bryce Granger.
That's true.
And we're always giving Bryce advice.
Props is the word you're
looking
for. Props.
And, yes. Okay, and we'll be giving him some more ideas today. You guys have been in Greenville for a while.
Yep.
Since 93 or 94.
93.
Wow. So it must have changed a lot since 93.
Yeah, it's really blown up. Mm-hmm. This downtown area, as you see, is very nice and charming. Didn't always used to be that way, but...
The hotel we're staying in, I understand, was boarded up.
Yeah.
At that time.
That's right.
And this whole area has become kind of a pedestrian... Mm-hmm. You know, food destination.
Yeah.
And absolutely. We went to that great river park.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. Falls Park, which, yeah, I think was put there in 2002, 2003, so even that is not too old. But, yeah, it used to be nothing down there. You know,
very industrial
mm-hmm.
and exactly. Fantastic municipal project,
yep.
And it's beautiful. I mean...
it is nice, yeah.
Frederick Law Olmsted, eat your heart out. It is really wonderfully designed, and mm-hmm. as far as I can tell... beautifully maintained. It's about 15 years old, Bryce said. And it's really just fantastic. Mm-hmm. Walking trails, et cetera. And families down there, runners down there.
Yep.
Really, and I saw a woman walking her two dogs and her parrot. and so we've been really enjoying it so far. So we're going to talk about a bunch of stuff today.
Yeah.
Right? Anything else you wanted to say about Greenville?
No.
Betty Buckley's in town.
For Hello Dolly. Have you guys seen Hello Dolly? Did you notice it's there?
Well, Hello Dolly. Get your butts down there.
Everyone's very
put on your
like,
Sunday clothes.
Was that you haven't seen it, you're not going to see it, you don't want to see it, you're sorry it's in town. Which is it?
I think it's all of the above.
Oh, my God. So we saw Hello Dolly in New York. It was really great. Not with Betty Buckley, but even so.
So one of the exciting things that's going on in this family is that Jenn and Bryan are expecting.
Yeah.
So we can't miss the opportunity to tell them how to raise their children. that in mind, we had Jenn read an article about raising a prodigy.
Yes.
Who's that article by?
Well, it's by the same guy who wrote the book.
David Epstein.
Right, so he wrote this, but that's why he's just promoting his book in the Times about the difference between raising a prodigy and one way or another, right?
Right. And so what did you get out of that article, Jen?
Yes, I got out of the article, you want a child prodigy, but not the way you think. So a lot of parents are telling kids early, here's a harp, stick with the harp from age 4. But really it's like, here's a bunch of instruments. Pick which one you want to do. And get kind of good in all of them, and then eventually something will pop for you. They cited Tiger Woods as like the exception to the rule, because Tiger Woods knew really early on, I like golf. But
his dad handed him a golf club when he was still in the roly-poly walker chair.
7 months old.
Yeah,
well, then the article, it was like mixed messaging, I felt, because say like he showed an aptitude for golf, so okay, and like Mozart, right? But otherwise, here's a variety of options.
So at the end, Epstein does say, that if your child wants to do it, that's fine. But don't think you have to set them on a particular route.
Right.
Because the studies show that the real successes, the more successful mature athletes are the ones who have sampled a variety of
And they're less likely to quit, right?
They don't get burned out.
It did make me think about a book I talk about a lot, but I've never actually read fully. Malcolm Gladwell's Outliers. Has anyone read that?
Yeah, Granger's read.
Okay,
Granger's
so, read like, yeah. that there's other factors, right? So it's like the best hockey players are born in one of 2 months because they were the youngest in the league or the oldest in the league.
Right.
Right? So I was curious how that...
Oh, there are a lot of factors.
Right, interact.
Yeah. And, of course, this doesn't just go for athletics, he points out. It goes for all kinds of academic pursuits,
heart, right.
technology, music, whatever. That the people who specialize intensely start out great guns out of the gate. But within a few years, other people who were slower to get into the game seem to surpass them in salary and advancement. Etc. That there's a certain value to having a variety of experiences that kind of fuel.
Which makes sense.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Does this mean I should cancel those newborn piano lessons?
No, keep those
we
out.
Did have a concert pianist coming in yes. to the birth room.
Spent
to start.
A lot of money.
If Baby Granger strides up to the piano and demands to
don't
play,
hold him back.
No.
That's right.
Yep.
It will find a more lucrative career to push into.
All right, so of course, Bryce being Mr. Mechanical Nut probably forced you guys at gunpoint.
That's right, that's the problem. That's the really what's right. going on here.
Okay,
you guys wanted to play piano, and he forced you to do things like build motorcycles.
Like
yeah, famously, Bryce will tell you that one of the great experiences of his fatherhood was building a motorcycle with Brendon. And so
we should pause here, Brendon. Was that one of the great experiences of your childhood?
It certainly was. I've built off of everything we did, so it was like a good foundation.
All right, good. I just wanted you to back him up on that. Yeah. It's public now. It's public record.
And so we kind of handed Brendon an article from the New York Times by...
Well, it's not, forget it's by. I mean, it's about a company that's now making motorcycles on a very small scale.
But what's interesting about that?
To me, there was a couple things. Having built a motorcycle and being a creator, it was just fun to see something thought up and made still here in America. You don't have to buy something from overseas that looks like everything else. You can find something here that's uniquely different.
Well, these guys, they were doing something else. The company's called Janus, right?
Mm-hmm.
And what was he doing before? He had a different career. Then he had a friend. And
well, don't...
They transitioned into mopeds and slowly built up.
Oh, yeah. Motorcycles.
But they're trying to build a retro-style motorcycle. Not... You and Bryce built a chopper?
Yeah.
Okay.
They were very popular at the time.
Right.
Yeah.
But
they've set their sights on crafting this retro-style motorcycle and making it roadworthy, which meant it had to meet certain requirements?
EPA standards, which usually deals with emissions out of the engine. There's not too much as far as regulation as building your own motorcycle says. We did the same thing. We had raw steel stickle and bent it, cut it into an actual frame. So anyone can kind of do it. And with South Carolina, it's a lot easier to title it. I don't know about other states.
Okay.
Well,
so they don't build the motor. They've sourced a motor.
They sourced the motor from overseas.
But they have everything else is handcrafted, and who do they get to build it?
They get it from the Amish.
From the Amish,
mm-hmm.
Okay. And the Amish don't use any mechanized vehicles.
Correct. They're usually used to 1 horsepower boats.
And tell us your theory about why the Amish might be the perfect people to handcraft even something like motorcycle parts.
Well, the article noted on it, but they're really well known for making very high quality furniture. So, when it comes to making a repeatable process to make the same tank fit every single motorcycle, you want it to be repeatable because you have to sell the tank if something happens to one and you want it to bolt right up. So, having a repeatable process is
and they have a good work ethic and pride in their. The quality of their crafting, et cetera.
They have limitations, too. They won't work for a certain kind of power, right?
Well, they don't use electricity, so what do they do?
They didn't use the electrical grid, but they would use welders that were powered off diesel generators.
Yeah.
There at the local building.
And
they had the community religious authorities approve this.
Yeah.
Okay. So. So it's kind of interesting. These motorcycles are retro. They're cool. All right. They go about 70 miles an hour.
Yeah, mm-hmm. and top speed, but that's good enough.
And they cost $6,000.
Yeah.
Which is very good.
Yeah, it's a good value some for something handcrafted like that. So, again, I smell retirement business.
First you said it was going to be Bryce and Steve together. Now you're talking about
Bryce and Brendon
together. Well, because Brendon shows such an interest, and he wants to do it. He wants to drop everything. And make that's what I'm hearing. Yeah, okay.
Absolutely.
maybe Lorna will get involved too, because there was talk of Lorna and Bryce having some kind of forge or something. I think she's
So we always do one obituary. At least. So Nikki Lauda died this week. And so, you know, I never know what people remember, what they know. But I just, downstairs getting clear. Now, you guys actually remember who Nikki Lauda was?
He was a little before my time. He won his championships in the 60s.
Yeah, 60s and 70s, yeah.
Most of the knowledge I have of him came from a pretty good movie 5 years ago.
The Ron Howard movie.
Yep, and documented the rivalry between Nikki Lauda and
Jim
James Hunt.
Yeah, exactly right. I think Chris Hemsworth was in that, wasn't he?
Absolutely, yep.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But it's crazy to me. We don't have to go into the details of Nikki Lauda, but I just remember it, and God knows there's nobody less interesting in race car driving than I am. And yet, I was alive in the 60s and 70s, and Nikki Lauda was the guy with the world champion driver. And what I remembered, of course, is that he almost killed himself. Mm-hmm. You probably remember that, and there was no joke about that. And they had the grisly details in the article. He lost half his face, he had an incredible burn.
But it was an accident.
An accident during one of the races, a Grand Prix race. And then he came back, and a few years later, he came in second for a championship, and then won the championship the year after.
Yep.
And he's just this determined, crazy guy. But, you know, he believed in what he was doing, and a fantastic race car driver.
He stayed very connected in the community.
Is that right?
He was always coming out to racetracks, so he was always...
Yeah, they had a Watkins Glen had a racetrack, Formula One. It's upstate New York, I guess. Yep. I don't know where the other ones are. In the U.S., are there others in the U.S.?
We now have one out in Texas.
Oh, is that right?
And they have the USA Grand Prix out in Texas.
Okay. Yeah, I think of that as Europe. But, you know. No. Okay.
All right.
Turmeric. We need a turmeric. We do that every week also.
Turmeric, yes. Turmeric will cure everything. And now is everybody's interested in turmeric cocktails. All right. Can you believe that? It turns the drink a beautiful yellow. And of course, as we know, it's an anti-inflammatory. And, you know, we all have inflammation. And so it talks about these different tip bartenders who are crafting these drinks, including one Jillian Vose, bar director and managing partner of the Dead Rabbit in Manhattan, which I'm sure we all are dying to go to. She uses turmeric in her drink, the Watchtower, which also contains Irish whiskey, brandy, and yogurt.
How could it possibly fail?
This sounds like that's quite the alcoholic smoothie. Not everybody is wild about turmeric in the drinks, especially the bartenders, because it stains everything, which is super, super true. I happen to make ice cream with turmeric in it. And, if you get it on the counter, it's a disaster. They interview Sean Kenyon, owner of the bar Williams and Graham in Denver, who doesn't dispute the perceived health benefits, but he also doesn't think that people should turn to cocktails to improve fitness.
Yeah.
As, you know, fabulous as that sounds. He says, I don't look for cocktails to be healthy. I look for cocktails to have booze in them, to be tasty and composed and balanced. Okay, so I think that's good advice. We will, if we want some fun, we'll have those drinks, but we won't design our fitness regimen around them.
Okay.
You
had a food article?
Yeah, Courtney and I were looking at a review of a couple of books. One is Julia Child, The Last Interview and Other Conversations. And it's just kind of fun because it brings Julia Child back. Have you ever watched any Julia Child?
I have not. I'm actually not the chef in the family. Brendon is definitely the cook, which he inherited from his mother. My mom is a true Southern cook. I mean, she loves her butter and her sugar, which I thought was interesting about that. It does talk about the article. Talks about Julia Childs and her love of butter and her unashamed and unabashed
love
of
butter. Plus her wonderful... Have you ever seen a Julia Child episode?
I haven't.
You should watch them. They're fun. And one of the great things about, they mentioned here her plummy voice and her enthusiasm. And she just had this great attitude about, you know, don't ever let people, you know, never apologize, never explain. You put it out there and you let them eat it. You know, Brendon seems like a cook, but I remember the time I tried to serve him poached salmon, cold poached salmon, and it was a total disaster. He said, I thought it would be hot. You know, like, who wants cold fish? Probably he's grown since then.
Maybe a little. Diversified. I don't know if he would still eat cold fish to this day. He won't even do sushi. Okay,
so that book was called Julia Child, The Last Interview and Other Conversations. There's another one called A Bite-Sized History of France, meaning food history of France, by Stéphane Aynaud, a French cheesemonger, and his wife, Jenny Mitchell, an American academic. And they really take you through the history of French food, starting with the Romans introducing the idea of vineyards to the French. So it's really the Italians who taught the French to make wine. That's interesting. So it's a fun book that gives you all kinds of little tidbits about French food, including the French McDonald's. Now, Bryan and I were talking about you go to Europe, you see the McDonald's, and you don't
all
go.
Over the place.
Okay, but turns out in France is the second most profitable market for McDonald's. Okay, it also turns out that the French version is not quite like the American version. They have croissants. They have baguettes. They have Roquefort burgers. Wow. Yum. And Le Croque McDo, which is just funny because we were at a little French cafe in Greenville this morning, all ordering croque monsieurs, et cetera. So that sounds kind of interesting. And it tells little details like Napoleon giving cognac to his troops as a morale booster, and points out that whiskey is more popular in France now than cognac. Yeah, so that sounds like a fun summer read, actually. So that's just what I wanted to bring to the table.
Yeah. That's good. All right, so movies coming up. I don't know if anyone has anything that comes to their mind that they're looking for. I can tell you what Bryce was telling us he wants to see. Do you want to guess what Bryce wants to see? You have any idea?
Is popular musician?
Rocket Man.
You guys are all over. I can't believe it.
The Elton John
I'm
biopic.
Shocked I'm saying to Bryce, really?
We spent many a car ride up to Cranberry with tapes of Elton John.
We had no idea that he was a
an Elton John
nut.
Yeah.
Well, it may have been that he only owned like two tapes.
That's probably it. Well, then he made fine distinctions. You know, you have to listen to the recordings, but live, he's not so great. Not so great. I go, really? He says, yeah. Anyway, he has all kinds of theories. He wants to see that movie. Anything else anybody want to see?
John Wick 3. John Wick France in the house.
Oh, really? Well, Wick, see, that's the strange thing about that. Every succeeding movie does better in that.
Yeah.
Two did better than one, three does better than
well,
two.
Well, I just saw John Wick 1 and 2 for the first time.
Really?
At home.
And?
And I really liked it.
Is it a little on the violent side?
It's very violent. A few times I have to close my eyes, I will admit. But the fight choreography is beautiful.
Really?
It's shot beautifully. I listened to a long interview with the director who comes from stunt work.
Right.
Worked with Keanu Reeves for a really long time. Yeah. So I want to see John Wick 3.
Yeah, Keanu Reeves is a mystery to me. Although
to a lot of people.
Yeah, he's married to Winona Ryder, I guess. I didn't realize that. It is true.
is that really true?
Yes. Apparently,
Keanu
Winona Ryder tells people.
Writer?
People don't realize it. But
no.
Winona Ryder makes it clear to people. You can check it. Go ahead.
I'm going to check it. I'm going to check it. It's going to blow my mind.
Circle.
Okay.
He has a lot of stock in a motorcycle company.
Is that right?
He's an avid motorcycle racer as well.
All right. Well, just to take the movies in a different direction, Tamsen found an article about John Waters. You heard an interview about John Waters, didn't you? Even beforehand.
Well, Bryan and I were talking about. Now, Bryan is in the arts field himself.
That's right. So I work at the Halsey Institute of Contemporary Art.
The Halsey?
Halsey Institute, yes. Named after William Halsey, who was an abstract expressionist who taught at the college for a long time.
What college?
At College of Charleston. My apologies. So the museum is a part of the college, is a program of the college, but we focus on contemporary art. And our current exhibition we just opened up last week is an installation by artist Jennifer Wen Ma, who's based in both New York City and Beijing. And she's created a giant installation of paper garden called Cryjoy Park, Gardens of Dark and Light. So it's a really massive installation, and it's been really exciting to work with her on it. I think it turned out very beautifully as well. So.
Okay, and I understand Bryce got to see the exhibition.
That's right. He flew down. Unfortunately, it wasn't for the exhibition. It was for the shower, our baby shower last week. But while Lorna, his wife, was attending that, he popped on down, and I got to show him the exhibition, which was great. There are some robotic elements, so there are parts of the sculptures that move towards you.
So it was a little bit accessible to him?
Exactly, yes. Yeah. So I got to show him one of our spares and show him exactly how we programmed it and how it runs and the sensors and all that stuff. So.
And I know he mentioned it to us because he enjoyed having an insight into your work.
Exactly.
A little bit.
It's always nice. I feel like I'm working so hard and then, you know, family never really sees anything I do. So it was very nice to
right. So you guys.
It's a great show, but I do have an update on the Keanu Reeves Winona Ryder
situation. Okay, and?
They got married for real during filming in the 90s.
Yeah.
And so then there that became like, oh, are they still married? But they're not married for real. They're not like husband and wife, like hanging out.
Are they legally married?
Well, that's an open question.
All right. Well, we'll resolve that in a further episode.
Okay. But anyway.
I was in the neighborhood. It's close enough.
Yeah,
to the
okay.
All right. Back to John Waters. So you read this article about John Waters.
Yeah. It's talking about his art collection, which you would imagine is perfectly John Waters.
Right. John Waters, movie.
Filmmaker
from Baltimore. Mm-hmm. Really, Pink Flamingos, what
exactly.
else?
It really pushes the envelope. Did this one called Polyester, which included a scratch and sniff card. So at various times in the movie.
Smell-o-vision.
Yeah, you would have to, you know, actually get the sensory.
But he's an authentically weird guy.
He is, yeah, very weird.
And so they talked about his art collection, which includes.
Yeah, it includes a Fishley Vice sculpture, which is just a pile of dog poop, a fake pile of dog poop, which just sits on the floor of his apartment.
Sounds
which I believe was noted that he has to clean that up before the cleaning people come in. Otherwise, they will
throw it out.
Well, he has a lot of floor art, and he says cleaning people don't like floor art.
Yeah, that's right.
So he keeps that away, and when he's in town, he sets it all back out.
Exactly.
I thought it was interesting that he says at this point, he's kind of through collecting.
Mm-hmm.
He only buys art if he can have it on the wall, if he can have it on display.
Exactly.
He doesn't want to just hold art. He just doesn't want to be owning art. He wants to enjoy it.
Yeah, and it's just perfectly reasonable. The article talks about how he bought a Warhol for $100 back in the 60s, which is, I mean, even if he's not investing, I'm sure he's doing quite well.
Yeah, right? A portrait of Jackie.
Yeah.
Oh, Jackie Kennedy.
Uh-huh.
And he's bought other Warhols, including one we can't even discuss.
Yes.
And we're not going to. And the Times wouldn't even print a picture of it.
Exactly.
So there you have it. An authentically weird guy, but fascinating.
Yeah, very
wonderful to hear him talk.
Yeah.
Weird from the get-go. When he was little, he loved car wrecks. And his mom would take him to junkyards. Well, and he would wander around with her and look at the smashed-up cars. I'm looking at Brendon because I bet he would enjoy that too.
Did you guys say that? You guys have to get going?
Or I think so, right. Yeah.
So we're going to cut off this segment, but I will say I think you may have all, you know, we appreciate having you here, and as a gift, I think take this to Hello Dolly. What do you think?
Yes.
That's what I'm thinking. All right. Well, thanks for being here. We'll
thank
do the last
you.
Absolutely.
Here, but we'll see you at the way.
Yeah.
All right. So that was great having the young people with us, right?
Sure.
We have a few more things we wanted to mention, a few more articles we were reading, including one you showed me that was in the New York Times, why the New York Public Library has 7 floors of stacks with no books. And so, of course, the New York Public Library is a massive system. They're talking about that enormous building at 42nd Street. Off of Bryant Park.
Yeah, it's
right?
a totally impressive building, and it's like a centerpiece of New York City, and you assume that it represents everything that a library should be, right?
Right, right.
Except
including
for one thing.
Books.
Except it's empty.
Okay. Famous for having all these books. A few years ago, 2012, most of the books were taken out.
Yeah,
and that's because the building as it stands is not a good place to store books.
No.
There are enormous windows that let all kinds of heat and light and moisture in that is destructive to books.
But the crazy thing is, so you have seven full floors that are empty, except they have these floor-to-ceiling bookshelves made of Andrew Carnegie steel with no books on them.
Right.
And then, and it's not, there are not going to be any books in them or any other use of that space for the foreseeable future.
They say it's not really feasible to kind of rework those floors to modern standards for the storage
of shell,
books.
Really. It's a little shell. I mean,
and mainly, there's a lot of use of digital material now, right? And it's not that the books are gone, sold or anything.
They're in storage.
They're in storage, mostly in New Jersey.
Right.
So within 24 hours, if you call up a book, it can get to you within 24 hours at the reading room in New York, but it's not in the building.
Right.
Now, not everybody's thrilled about that. They say a library should have books. And this library, Daniel, had everything. Everything.
Well, I saw
including
that. All the Vogue article, all the Vogue magazines.
Every Vogue and magazine. Result? Every phone book from all over the country.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, God.
All the phone books, collectible comic books, underground literature from the Soviet Union, the first printed collection of Shakespeare, copy of the Declaration of Independence, it's just not a great place to be storing these 11 million books and 40 million documents, photos, and research materials. The facility in New Jersey is purpose-built, according to modern standards, to maintain that kind of stuff. What do you use that space for? Right now, it's empty. People say, part of the reason it's empty is you're right, it's got stacks in it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not like it's empty rooms that you could be holding parties in. It would have to be reworked or whatever. But shocking to have a library with no books, and shocking to have seven floors of Midtown empty space.
Yeah, crazy.
We'll see what happens.
There was an article about salt mines. We've talked about salt mines before. Spas that were the salt lined.
We went to a salt mine in Bogota, right outside of Bogota, and we marveled at what a really awful place it must have been.
To work it,
okay?
It's called working in the salt mines.
Right, your parents
negative
used to,
connotations.
Well, I always had a boring, tedious job, back to the salt mines, okay? But here in Salahorsk, Belarus, there's a salt mine that currently is the home for the National Speleotherapy Clinic. So you can actually go in the salt mines and it's a health treatment. Now, we've read about spa situations where you go in a room and it's lined with salt and it's supposed to be therapeutic for you. But here you can actually go in to the salt mine. You can spend the night if you like. And supposedly, it improves your health in many, many ways because it's free from all contaminants like pollen, and other, invisible, contaminants is the word, from our life above ground, okay? And people say, especially people suffering from allergies, and et cetera, that they go down there, they spend the night, or they spend 6 hours. You can also just spend 6 hours and, hang out there and come out. And they say it dramatically improves their lives.
Yeah, good.
Mostly it's people from Belarus who are doing it. Because the cost is paid for by their national health program.
Ah, well, then you go.
Okay, so that helps.
Yeah.
And Russians, who are currently paying $1,000 for a 2-week stay.
Well, I don't know.
So one American has been there
and
seemed to think it was okay. But it has yet to really, they don't want tourists. They want people who seriously want to be healed.
All right. I'm skeptical. I'm really.
So another, in Bogota, they were promoting the salt mine as a tourist attraction with the cathedral, okay? And in Belarus, they're promoting it as a health venue.
Yeah. Yeah, well, you got the salt mines. You got to do something with them. You know, they used to store nuclear material in salt mines. They still do that.
Well, and of course, there's the famous art. The Nazis hid
put the art, yeah.
The stolen art
right.
In the salt mines.
Yeah, that keeps things fresh.
So not to rub salt in a wound.
Oh, God, yeah.
But I feel like I'm not seeing the Bucks in the final MBOF playoff.
The MBOF?
The MBOF.
Well, first of all, we have to go back.
I'm no longer fearing
the
fear.
Let me set this. You're right about that.
Apparently, Raptors top... Deer.
Yeah. Well, look, there's two stories. We now have the final set in both hockey and basketball. I don't want to neglect hockey. And what's interesting about this is that it's the Boston Bruins, I should say, against the St. Louis Blues in hockey. And what's startling about that is that at the beginning of the season and much of the season, the St. Louis Blues were the last place team in the NHL. And what do I mean by that?
Last place this year.
But there are many leagues, understand. There are 31 teams in the NHL. They had the worst record in the NHL at the 45% of the season mark. That's bad.
This smells like the Mets, doesn't it?
Well, it shows you that the Mets are in good position. Well, the Mets, you can't give up on these teams. That's the point. You can't give up. A lot of people would have given up on the St. Louis Blues, and there they are now in the finals against the Boston Bruins, and who knows? They might win. So we'll see. No prediction there. Because, as you like to point out, once in a while my predictions fail. And we have the NBA final. It does not fear the dear Milwaukee Bucks. They played last night. Granger, did you watch that game at all?
Yes, I saw a lot of the second half.
Yeah, so did I. And the Bucks deserve to lose. You know, I will tell you.
What happened? They fall asleep? Because I fell asleep.
Yeah.
Watching the game.
Somehow they stayed awake, even though you fell asleep. But the truth is, every once in a while you watch Giannis, and you say, you know, he didn't grow up playing basketball. He does some things that someone growing up playing basketball would not do. He does some things wonderfully well as a natural athlete, and some things wonderfully poorly as someone who hasn't played much basketball.
But maybe maybe it's the child prodigy situation. He's growing into the role.
He'll get better.
Is it possible he'll mature more?
Oh yes. Yeah. But right now, I think I'm just looking at Granger one way or another. Wouldn't you say that Kawhi Leonard, the star of Toronto, right now is a better basketball player than Giannis?
Yes, he's a more complete player, but I think that Kawhi is also just like a better one-on-one player, and Giannis is a very good team player, but sometimes the game slows down and becomes different in the playoffs.
Yeah, that's true.
The playoffs are a lot more half-court basketball.
And Giannis is a fast break guy, they should have made more of an effort to get the ball out and run.
Yeah, Kawhi can dribble better, Kawhi can do pick and roll, Kawhi can shoot better.
That's the big thing.
He
can shoot better. Giannis is not a great shooter. Why they set up Giannis so far from the basket, I don't understand. But
I think the coach failed to adapt to the situation they were in, saying to himself, like, okay, we've been having a very successful season, we're going to do what we do, instead of adapting to the current opponent, which is playing a zone against Giannis.
Yeah. All right, so they lost out. It might have worked out better, but it didn't. They've gone fishing, as Granger reminds me, one says when someone gets knocked out of the playoffs. So we will ease out of the
podcast. With our favorite version of Gone Fishing.
That's Bing Crosby and Louis Armstrong singing Gone Fishing.
Meanwhile, we're going to a wedding.
We're going to a wedding.
So here we go.
But if we go fishing, this would be a lovely place to do it. Greenville, South Carolina. Tamsen Granger, Dan Abuhoff.
See you again next week.
At Tamsen, Dan, read the paper.
I tell you why I can't find you. Every time I go out to your place, you gone fishing.
Ah, you know.
Well, there's a sign upon your door.
Uh-huh.
Gone fishing.
I'm real gone, man.
You ain't working anymore.
Could be.
There's your hole out in the sun where you left a row half done. You claim that hoeing ain't no fun.
But I can prove it.
You ain't got no ambition. Gone fishing. By a shady, weighty pool.
Shangri-La. Really la.
I'm wishing I could be that kind of fool.
Shall I twist your arm?
I'd say no more work for mine.
Welcome to the club.
On my door I'd hang a sign. Gone fishing. Instead of just a wishing.
Papa Bing, yeah, I've stopped by your place a time or two lately, and you aren't home either.
Well, I'm a busy man, Louie. I got a lot of big deals cooking. I was probably tied up at the studio.
You aren't tied up, you dog. You just playing old gone fishing. There's a sign up on your door.
Pops, don't blab it around, will you?
Gone fishing.
Keep it shady. I got me a big one staked out.
You ain't working anymore.
I don't have to work. I got me a piece of Gary.
Cows need milking in the barn.
I have the twins on that detail. Each take a side.
But you just don't give a darn.
Give them 4 bits of cow and hand lotion.
You just never seem to learn.
Man, you taught me.
You ain't got no ambition.
You're convincing me.
Gone fishing. Got your hound dog by your side.
That's old Cindy Lou going with me.
Gone fishing. Fleas are biting at his hide.
Get away from me, boy, you're bothering me. Folks won't find us now because Mr. Satch and Mr. Cross, we gone fishing. Instead of just a wishing.